I plead the blood of Holy Yahushua over this video and over the mind, body, and spirit of every child of Yah watching this video in Yahushua HaMashiach's holy name.
The letter Yud is the smallest of all of the letters, and it is referred to as Hama'at HaMachziket Merubeh, the little that holds a lot. It is the first letter of God's name of four letters. So that tells us this is a very, very important archetypal, powerful letter. For an infinite God to create a finite world, it necessitated what was called tzimtzum, a contraction. Because in a philosophical sense, where would an infinite God put a finite world? Sounds simple, but it's much more complicated than that. That God needed to, as it were, contract his infinite being to make place for a finite world. The letter Yud, more than any other letter, represents this concept of contraction. And that is why it's called the little that holds a lot. Now, this is very similar to modern science's explanation of the Big Bang, where our present universe of tens of billions of galaxies, each with tens of billions of stars, we're told all came from an infinitely small point that exploded, the Big Bang. This is the Yud. This is the archetypal energy represented by the Yud in the worlds, in the souls, and the level of divinity. The number Yud equals 10. And because of its importance as the first letter of God's name, and the fact that all 22 letters conceptually have a Yud in them, when you put the pen to the paper, that first point, that is the Yud. And just like science explains that all of physical reality is made up of atoms, and that if one wanted to envision all of creation, it's just, in a sense, a virtually endless series of atoms. But we look at the Yud in the same way. It's as if all of creation is an infinite series of Yuds. The Yud equals 10. Any number, when it's multiplied by 10, represents its full manifestation. So 10 is 10 times 1. In other words, the oneness of God is manifest in plurality through the letter 10. Thus, the number 10 of all of the numbers is one of the most important. And there are countless different ideas in our tradition that have 10 in them. On the level of worlds, we have the 10 expressions through which God brings the world into being. We're told also in our tradition that there were 10 things created on the first day. There were 10 things created at dusk of the sixth day. On the level of souls, we see that Abraham, the first Jew, had 10 tests, all of which he passed. And through that, he merited, as it says in the Torah, to inherit a land of 10 nations. Number 10 is the day of Yom Kippur. Yom Kippur is called the holiest day of the year, and it comes out on the 10th day of the month of Tishrei. We give a tenth of our income to charity. And when we take our crops from the field, we also give a tenth in the ancient time before we could enjoy it. This is what's called tithing. On the level of divinity, we have the 10 Svirot, the archetypal emanations through which creation comes into being. We have the 10 plagues through which God revealed his power and his caring and ability to act in the world. And this culminated when we came out of Egypt and God giving us the 10 commandments. And we're told that all of the mitzvahs, all of the commandments of the Torah are contained within these 10 commandments. A very, very profound meditation on the letter Yud is to look deeply inside and to understand how much potential is there, how much holiness is contracted within us, and to be able to focus on that and how to bring that into fruition and into the world.
If this is the first time you're seeing one of our videos, please go back and watch Introduction to Wakefulness Theology. It is on the home page when you arrive as a new subscriber to our channel, or you can also find it as the first video in the new playlist, Holy Yahushua's Name, right here. Thank you so much. It will help you understand what we're talking about. Holy is Yahushua. Shalom! Shalom, priests! Shalom! I pray that you're blessed today in Yahushua Mashiach's holy name. Today is not the Sabbath. I'm actually recording on Monday. So it is Monday, July 27th. I took the weekend off and had a birthday weekend, and you guys won't believe what happened. Let's just get to it. Quick update. The night before I left for my birthday weekend, we went out of town. I had a dream that I went down to the basement to get something out of the basement. I don't have a basement, but it was a basement. I got what I wanted, and when I was ready to leave, the darkness started coming on me. Like, I could feel it trying to keep me in the basement. And then the darkness started closing the door. So this was like, you know, evil. It was just bad. Something bad was going to close the door to lock me down in the basement. And I said, I know this really well because I told you guys already years ago, before Father called me into remembrance of who I am and before he brought me back to him, I was having nightmares about being in a haunted house for years, and it was horrible, horrific. So I know this feeling, right? So right away I said, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, open the door, or keep the door open, something to that effect. And the door opened wide. And then I was going to walk out of the room, but I couldn't. I don't know, I was stuck, I was frozen. And I said, get me out of here. And when I said that, my body just, it propelled forward through the door, but I didn't walk. It just was like, spit me out of the room, right? And as before that happened, the voice said, Holy Yahushua said, go home. And then he pushed me out the room. And when he pushed me out the room, I woke up out of my dream. You know what I mean? It was like, that was something. That was an experience. He said, go home. So when I woke up, I was like, well, what does that mean? I don't know if you guys know, but I've lived all over America. I was born in the Midwest by Chicago, family in Chicago, lived in Seattle, Washington, went to school in Tacoma, Washington, lived in Philadelphia, lived in New York. My dad lives in Texas. I lived in Texas. My mom's in Las Vegas. I got family in California. I've lived in Italy. I've just lived all over the place. So I'm like, well, what is home? You can throw a dart. What is home? I don't know. But I said, you know, Holy Father, wherever you want me to go, you know, just tell me. And I said, you know what, just make it happen. If you want me to go home, then just make it happen and I'll go. You know what I mean? That's what I said. And then you won't believe what happened. He has sent me home. Now, two years ago, when before Notre Dame burned, I did a video in front of Notre Dame where I had received a message. I think I didn't interpret the message well, but if you watch the video, you understand the point. I was saying that I had a limited time in Paris left. I have been here for 20 years and I'm going to be leaving Paris soon. That I knew that. What I didn't understand was that the message wasn't only talking about me leaving. It was also talking about world events, you know, including Notre Dame and all of that stuff. But so we've been preparing for this since I did that Notre Dame video, right? And I've been going around Paris and giving messages in different places in Paris just to kind of, I guess, say goodbye and to summarize, you know, all of the different messages that I've received over my over the time that I've been here in Paris. You know, this whole preparation of me leaving, and I didn't know where I was going. So then I thought it was Africa, right? Because Father told me I would be leaving Paris soon. And to wrap up, the message was something like I had to finish the projects that I came here to do, music projects. I had to finish up whatever it was I came here to do because I would be leaving soon, right? And so that's what I've been doing. And then the Africa came up, the African Union delegation work that I've been doing. And I got sent to Ethiopia. So then I said, well, maybe Father is going to be sending me to Africa, right? We have all these messages about Exodus and all of this. So I'm like, okay, Father's going to be sending me to Africa. Well, you know, Father, make it happen. Because just like when he sent me to Ethiopia, I didn't pay for nothing, right? So I was like, well, that's how you're going to have to send me to Africa. It's just going to have to be like, here's the ticket, here's your house, go and, you know, prosper and be well. So that's what I was saying. I was like, Father, wherever my home is, just make it happen. Guess what? I don't want to say where the town is right now. I want to keep some privacy, and it's not a done deal yet. So I'm just updating you on the situation. So I won't tell you the town, but we went outside of Paris in France, stayed at a friend's house just to see if we like the town. And we really loved the town. We fell in love with the town. And so we told our friend who lives there, and they said, hey, we own a property and our friend owns a house, and do you want to see it? And we said, yeah. And they sent us the pictures, and it's just our dream house. It's just a dream house. And so I was doing a promotion video for my new song, and the new song is called Let's Go Home. And as you can see on the screen, I was talking about the song Let's Go Home in front of the cathedral of this town. So when I got home, I was asking Father, I was like, you told me to go home, where is home? And then I looked at the video and it had my face, it says home on it, it says Let's Go Home, and then I'm right in front of that cathedral. And that was directly after our friend offered us this house in this place. And I was just like, wow, that's what it is. Father is sending me to another town in France outside. It's not in Paris. So I'm leaving Paris, not directly going to Africa right away, but he's sending me to this place, and I believe it's a place of safety because it's in the forest. It's in the wilderness. He's sending me to the forest, guys, priests. So I will be going to the forest. the cost of living, it will cut our expenses in half, because living in Paris is very expensive. So where we're going will be half the price of what we pay now, and we'll be able to save money and be in nature and be quiet and away from all of this pestilence and all of these things that are happening in society. So I just want to quickly just give all praise, glory, and honor to the Most High Father. Thank you, Father, for speaking to me. Thank you, Father, for sharing, allowing me to share these messages with my brothers and sisters, your children. And I pray that it gives them hope. I pray that it strengthens their faith. And I pray that they as well receive as clearly as I did, if not even clearer, if they receive the message of where they are to go. And Father, just let it happen for them, just like you did for me. Just put it in place. Boom, boom, boom. Here's your house. Here's your key. Go home. And just push them out the door and just send them to where they're supposed to be, Father. Let their feet land on the path that you have set before them. And Father, just protect them over this upcoming events that are to happen, and just protect them. Just Father, protect them. Keep your hedge of protection over them, and send your angels, your warring angels, and strike down anything demonic in, on, or around them. And Father, just keep them safe so that they can continue to grow in you and become your bridal army. In Yahushua HaMashiach's holy name, I claim these prayers accomplished in faith and in expectation. In Yahushua HaMashiach's holy name we pray, Amen. So there you go, priest. I will keep you posted. I'm going down on Friday to visit the house to see if it's, you know, if it's what we want, really. And then I'll probably be leaving Paris within the next 2 months, 2 or 3 months maximum. So prophecy fulfilled, prophecy fulfilled, prophecy fulfilled. Father told me that I would be leaving Paris. He told me to go home. And now he's sending me to the forest, to the wilderness, where I can rest and continue working. So all praise, glory, and honor to him. We're going to continue on this playlist, Yahushua HaMashiach's holy name, the IAO, the Alpha, and the Omega. Up until now, I think the videos have been pretty easy to follow. Like, you can watch them and understand them if you're called and chosen and Holy Spirit filled. You can understand them and follow them. But now we're at a different level. Now we're entering the 10-10. I've already explained what it means, the twins, and what the 10-10 means and all of this. I've already explained that in past videos, so I pray that I did a good job explaining and that you understand this is the beginning of our development as the manifested body of Christ on earth, as true spiritual Israel, as the two witnesses, the two candlesticks, as the 144,000, as the remnant church, as the first fruits, whatever name you want to call it, as the five groups of the bridal army, whatever name you want to call it. This is the beginning of us being cleaned and prepared for that. Okay? So you can be called and chosen and not able to follow this playlist. You know why? Because you first have to be to a certain level of maturity, and you also have to be either complete or on your way to becoming complete. And I explained what that means in the last video. So when we're looking at Ezekiel's temple, we're already past the five groups, okay? And now we're on the seven, we're on the stairs of the seven. And once you go from five, you go to seven, and then from there you go to eight. Once you have your seven, then you receive your eighth person, which is the olive tree, right? And then at that point you are complete. And that's when you're in the inner circle of the temple, and you're ready to make your way into the Holy of Holies. You remember. So in order for you to understand this, what I'm about to begin to explain now, and we're going to go through his name. So this is the first row of his name. So in order for you to be able to follow this playlist, you have to not only be watching the videos, you have to be living this. Right? So, for example, if you're sitting at home in your basement by yourself, you're not talking to nobody, you're not doing anything except sitting in your basement and watching videos, you're not going to be able to follow. Do you see what I mean? Because you're incomplete. You have to receive your name or be in the process of receiving your name. You have to be at least with at least four other people that are like-minded like you. If you don't have other people in your circle that are priests or working to be priests, you need to come together. You see the first line of this chart right here, Dan 10, 10, 21, 2021 to 2023. Do you see this first line? What does it say? It says, the assembly of the saints. That's the meaning, the assembly of the saints. I already went through in the past, you can do your own research and you know, confirm that for yourself. If I try to confirm every meaning of this, it'll take me 10,000 million years, so I can't do that. It's your responsibility. You go and do the research on that. But that's what I have understood in the work that we've already done in the past. 10:10, the assembly of the saints. So if you're sitting at home in the basement or in your bedroom by yourself and you're not assembled with anybody, you're not going to understand what I'm going to say next. You're not going to get it because you're by yourself. At this point, you need to be assembling yourself with brothers and sisters in Christ, other priests, other called and chosen people. And I know it's not easy. I know it's not easy because I've been doing this work for 3 years and bringing people together through the wakefulness theology that are our priests. So I know it's not easy, but you have to do that work. You cannot go forward and truly understanding if you don't. So at this point, you need to at least be finding four other priests to be communing with at the minimum, and be ready to be getting into the seven. And once you get into your seven, then you can receive your eight. Do you see what I mean? So you're going to be at a disadvantage if you're not following the process. It's not enough for you to just watch the videos and understand in theory what's happening. You have to be living this. It's the same for the song. Last week I explained the song, either the song that is preparing us to sing the song of the 144,000 or the actual 144,000 song. I don't know, but we're receiving now the song that we are going to be singing, or we have already started, and we will continue for the next 2 years minimum to sing on his wounds together. There could be some confusion if you're not actually living this life. Do you see what I mean? Because last week I showed a sister in Christ and she was explaining what she had received as the song. And the song that we have received is not the same song as hers. It's very, very similar. And I will be developing the song that we're using already through Holy Spirit and taking the scripture and taking some understanding from that sister and taking the understanding that Holy Spirit has already given me and just developing it a little bit more. But it's not the exact song that I presented last week. Do you see what I mean? And even the exact song that was presented last week, if you aren't in the Holy Spirit, you're not going to know how to sing it. Do you see what I mean? That's what the scripture says. The scripture says only the 144,000 will be able to sing that song because of everything I'm explaining to you right now. It's not enough for you to be presented the information. You have to be living this life. You got to be about that life to understand what we're about to start learning here. Do you see what I mean? So if you're not about that life and you see the sister song and you're going to be confused, you'll be like, well, I don't understand. What am I supposed to do with that? How is that supposed to work? I don't know. You don't know. And that's why we say, you know, confusion is of the enemy. It's not of the Most High Father, because the people who are in this process, they're doing the work. They're assembling themselves with their brother and sisters as we are commissioned to do. We are commissioned to commune together. Okay, this is not like a choice. This is a commission given by Father. We are to assemble ourselves in our groups to begin our training, and we are to begin singing on his new moons. So if you're actually doing that, then you know the song, or you will know the song. You'll get the right song. If you're sitting at home by yourself, just like watching it like a tourist, if you're like watching these videos like you're a tourist, you're not going to get it. You're going to be confused. And if you get confused, that's how you know you're not doing it right. That's the enemy right there. The other thing that you need to have before you can go further in this is you're going to need strength. You see this right here? Strength. This is the first line. I know it seems like I'm talking a lot. I feel like I'm bumping my gums a whole bunch, but I'm only on the first line here. The first line of the first line. Strength. Because what I've understood already from experience, once more, this comes directly from heaven. This is not in my imagination. This is what's happening, okay? Our first menorah, we have our eight people. That is established. I've explained it in the past, and I'm going to clarify it again in this video. We have our eight people, so I am complete. I've received confirmation through the holy letters that I'm complete. Okay, I have my eight people here. So now we've received direct confirmation from the Most High Father that we are to sing eight times, right? So that we are cleaned. I assume that's 1 month for each person. I don't know, it just seems like it. What I've realized is that since we've been eight people, eight equally yoked people to me, I feel a strength and a power and a heightening of my spiritual abilities that I didn't have before. And we only have one of our menorahs. So just imagine when we are united with both of our menorahs, you know, me and you, you have your menorah, you have a twin menorah, you know, us. When a person is united with both of your menorahs, the power and the strength. Do you see what I'm saying? It's just like, okay, heightened abilities, just like it explains in the prophecies. Okay, but in order to get to that place, you need to assemble yourselves, all right? And at that point, that's when Father begins to teach us about our powers and how to use them. And that process has already started happening. And I'll either be presenting it at the end of this playlist or it'll be the next playlist. But Father is beginning to explain and show me what it means to be an airbender, what it means to be a firebender, what it means to be an earthbender, and what it means to be a waterbender. These are weapons to fight the enemy, okay? And I'll come back and explain that in another later in the video today, and then we'll expound upon it later. But in order for you to start to get your powers, in order for you to start to learn how to use your powers, you have to be in your menorah, okay? And then that's when you get that arm. And that's when you get that strength. So right here at the beginning of this video, I showed you the explanation of Yud. And so just more understanding. I've already explained Nun, so I'm not gonna go back and explain Nun in every video. If you guys don't know what about Nun yet, please go back and review the past playlist. You need to be watching the entire past playlist to understand, to get to this point. Not only living it, but having the information. So let's look a little bit more at Yud, because it's explaining exactly what I just said about strength. You see right here, it looks like an arm, right? So at the beginning, there was a brother who was explaining the Hebrew meaning of Yud. I just want to point out to you the Paleo Hebrew meaning of Yud, and you can see right here, it's a hand and your work. It's an arm and a hand and your work. For example, hand on a cross. So we've seen before in a letter line about your solar plexus, and that representing the arm of Yah, your strength and your power. And that's what it is. It's when you have the strength and the power of Father, right? His arm, right? You're able to carry the burdens. You see, because you have the elbow here, and that's where you carry a heavy weight, you're able to carry the burden. This right here is the arm. Work, throw, make, praise, Yud. And these are the different configurations over time. They change. So this brother here, I am going to be using his videos to explain the different Hebrew letters as we go through. I'm not telling you to watch his channel. I don't know him. I don't know his religion. I don't know none of that. It's just he is explaining in short videos, quick and easy, the meaning of the letters. And that's the only reason I'm sharing his videos. So if you guys look him up and you don't like the way he smells, you don't like his wife, you don't like his dog, that's between you and him, okay? I'm just using this information to easily explain Hebrew letters, and I'll be doing that throughout this series, okay? So as I just shown you, what I explained about you need to be strong, you need to have strength. Why? Because every time you're going up these levels, every level here I'm gonna show you, every level here that we're gonna go through, you see, every level has a year, 3.5 years for each line, and we have 7 years of the beginning of sorrows, right? Because I received on December 26, 2018, the beginning of sorrows. This week it begins, a week is 7 years. So from here, which is 2020 up until 2027-ish, 2028, I don't know exactly. We'll have to do a calculator to figure out the exact date, which I did, but I don't have it in front of me right now. This right here is the beginning of sorrows. So each line that you go through is an evolution. So there's a next level devil at every line, okay? Do you understand? Do you hear what I'm saying to you? There is a gatekeeper at every line. There is a gatekeeper at every line, all right? Every time you sing his holy name on a new moon, you get a new gatekeeper, okay? And this is not easy. It's getting more and more difficult. And I'm telling you this not because I read a book. I'm telling you this from my personal experience, because we were set as leaders. People want to think that it's some kind of ego thing. It's not an ego thing. It's a job. It's a job that we have to go first and spy the land and come back and report to you what it is so that it can help you get through easier. It's a job. It's a sacrifice. It's not easy. It's really hard. It's nothing about nobody's ego. This is real. Okay? So we have to go through this first so we can report back to you what's going on. Okay? So I'm reporting back to you what's going on. Every time you sing his holy name, every time you go up one of those levels, there's a next level devil. There is a gatekeeper that you have to get past. Okay? And let me tell you, you cannot read my lips. You cannot get past the gatekeeper if you have any of the deadly sins or any of the seven enemies of Yisrael inside of you. If you have any blockages, if you have any kaka, you're not going to pass. You're not going to pass. You're not going to pass. It has been clearly shown to me why the world is in the state that it is right now. Because every time children of Yah, good people, God-fearing people, get together and try to build something, the enemy immediately infiltrates that and tears it apart from the inside. How is he able to do that? He's able to do that because inside of us, we have weaknesses, we have openings, we have sin, we have whatever, you know, and the enemy is able to get in and plant evil seeds and just turn people against each other, the divide and conquer, and it's a wrap. It has happened every time. It works every time. It's only a matter of time, right? It's like you can fight the good fight for a few years, maybe even a millennium, but eventually the enemy works his way in there, right? That has been our experience, and tell me it hasn't. Tell me it hasn't. Look around the world. Times are different now. This is the end times. And this is why we have the necessity of the two olive trees and the two candlesticks and the 144,000 and his bridal army, etc. That's why we're here. That's why. Because unless you are completely surrendered to the Father as a first fruit. And we've already explained what that means. That means you are sacrificed. That means you are dead to the matrix outside of the fact that you're living for Yah. Everything you do, everything you smell, everything you eat, all the time, from the time you open your eyes to the time you go to sleep, belongs to Yah completely. So unless you are a first fruit in that way, and you have gotten rid of your kaka, and you have defeated these enemies of Yisrael, unless that has happened, it won't work. So we are a group of eight people, and we're the first in our, at least in our group. I don't know about the whole world of the, you know, but at least in our group, we're the first menorah to be assembled. We're going to start singing eight times very shortly. And before we start singing, we have to confess our sins to each other. We have to strengthen each other and help each other, because the weakest person in the group is the weakness of everybody. The strongest person of the group is the strength of everybody. It's one for all and all for one. Do you see what I mean? It is a unity that we don't really know in churches today. That's what a menorah is. So you have to know each other, trust each other, love each other. It's your new spiritual family. And that's the same with the twins. You don't know who your twin is, but you have to go out there and get to know people. You have to get out there and open up your heart and find out. You have to explore. You have to do the work. That's the only way you're going to find your twin. That's the only way you're going to find your menorah. That's the only way you're going to find the other people that you need to go up. Because every level has this test, and every level has this trial and tribulation and cleaning. That's what it is. It's a cleaning. That's why Father said we had to go through this eight times, eight new moons. Do you know how clean we're going to be in 8 months? Because the gatekeepers, what they put you through at every level is just crazy. It's crazy because they're scared. We have the enemy running scared. Okay, because we are on the cusp of fulfilling this prophecy that is something that we can't even fathom right now. He is cleaning us and bringing us into our calling as the remnant church, as the first fruits. And this is driving the enemy nuts. They're losing their mind. They don't know what to do. They're running scared. Okay, they're coming at us with everything they got. Okay. And the only way you can get through this is in unity, in love with your brethren. Get rid of the kaka. Overcome the seven enemies of Yisrael. This is the only way you're going to make it to the promised land. And like I said before, the promised land, at the moment, it happens first spiritually. So we're talking about inside of you. Then you can go to the actual promised land. But you can't. Y'all playing around. You're playing around, sitting at home by yourself, watching this, like watching a video is going to save you. Watching this video is not going to save you. It can help you. It can help you understand and give you clarity on what to do. So I pray that you do it right now. Start finding your people. If you need help, come. We're at Wakefulness Theology. We're assembling ourselves. Maybe this is where you belong. I don't know. Right now, we're really tightening the belt because we're under a heavy attack. So I pray that if you're able to come and join us, that you do. So what I just explained is the first line about the assembly of the saints and the strength, true spiritual Israel, which are the seven pillars and the seven stones. We explained that last week as well. Okay, the double portion and Joshua, the son of Nun, leading Yisrael to the promised land. Let's look at that a little bit more. I received a direct audible message from Holy Yahushua this week. I was told to keep it secret, that it is too sacred to be shared. So I won't be able to tell you the direct message that he gave me, but I can't explain how it happened because that was amazing. And I believe it's another tool that can help you to purify yourselves so that you're able to go up in these levels. I was sleeping and I started being attacked. We've been under attack for a while now. We're getting really close. I started having thoughts. It was thoughts, but the thoughts weren't coming from me. You can feel when you have a thought from yourself and when you have a thought that arrives that is not from you. So I was having bad thoughts that weren't from me. And so what I did was how Holy Yahushua taught me in the videos, if you guys look back, when I received enlightenment, which was the light flash that was in my head, and I heard the word, it said enlightenment. And then I was taught how in your brain you have neurological paths that have been established. So for example, if you have a memory and you tell a friend about that memory, and then you tell another friend about that memory, and then you tell another friend about that memory, after a while you have established a bridge, and at the tips of my fingertips, that's where that memory is, right? If you've connected two neurons here. So whether your memory is correct or incorrect, this has been established. So it's difficult to break the connection if it's something that you don't want. Once it's established, it takes work to break it, and then you have to re-establish new connections, right? So it's not enough to just break it, but you also have to change the behavior with new behavior. So that's what the Holy Spirit taught me in those videos that, you know, please go back and watch those videos. So this was kind of like me putting that into practice. So the enemy was attacking me with these negative thoughts. And so right away I said, well, that's not how I feel. The way I feel is the opposite of what it was saying. So I was just, for example, I was saying, I could say, I'm trying to give you an example without telling you all my business, if that makes sense. So let's say I was saying, I love Holy Yahushua. I love Holy Yahushua. I love Holy Yahushua. I hate evil. I love Holy Yahushua. I hate evil, right? So the enemy is trying to say something that is not what I believe. And I'm fighting that with reinstating what I believe. And what I believe is I love Holy Yahushua and I hate evil, right? So I had to do this over and over and over in my mind. I'm like, I love Holy Yahushua and I hate evil. And as I was doing this, I was able to feel my brain, because if you remember, we've learned that the emotions are in our brains. It's not in our heart. We think with our heart and we have emotions in our brain, okay? So I was starting to imagine my brain and imagine the way your brain looks, the white, you know, the gray matter with the folds and everything. So up under those folds are hidden memories, hidden experiences, things that have happened to you in your past. It might have been a long, long time ago, and it might have been very, very small. It might have been something like when you were in fifth grade, some kid said that you were fat and you hated that kid, and you know, you forgot all about that. You forgot that that ever happened, but you have established a seed of hate from that experience. And so it's hidden in there. It's a very small thing. It's easy to get rid of. You just don't know it's there, right? It's hidden under the flap of your brain somewhere, right? What it is that the enemy is hiding that experience and that feeling from me so that I don't clean it out. They're hiding it. So anytime I start to come close to discovering that thing, it'll put something negative in front so that I run away from it. Do you see what I mean? So let's say right here, this is a treasure, okay? This is treasure. I'm me, and this is treasure. The enemy doesn't want me to find the treasure. So as soon as I turn to go towards the treasure, the enemy is gonna say, you know, something negative, something negative, something I don't like, something negative. I don't like it, I don't like it. So that I'm going to turn away from the treasure. I'm going to turn away from it. I'm going to go away from it because of all of this hoopla that I don't like. Now that could take the form of many things. It could take the form of insecurities. It could take the form of bad thoughts. It could take the form of temptations. It could take the form of, I don't know, whatever. It's just the enemy making noise to keep you from discovering whatever it is that you need. You have to get to that thing, okay? Whatever it is, you have to get there, okay? So in this experience, which happened very recently, I was, you know, fighting, and I was just like, I love Holy Yahushua and I hate evil. And you might have to do that for hours. You might have to do that for hours, for days. You might have to do that for hours, for days, for weeks, for months. You have to do it until you break through. Okay. If you are insecure people, a person, and the voice is saying, I'm so insecure. I'm so insecure. I'm so insecure. You have to fight it. And you have to say, I have the strength of Yah. I have the strength of Yah in me. I have the strength of Yah, whatever it is. You have to affirm it over and over and over until you shut that other thing down. Do you see what I mean? So I was going through this process and I could see in my brain, literally, spiritually, I could see in my brain where that thing was. And I dug down deeper into it. And then I started to see some experiences in my past where I was angry at somebody. And I said, you know, I repent. I repent of, you know, allowing myself to be angry. I forgive that person. I forgive myself. You just release it. Just, it's really easy because it's not like big, horrible sins or something. It's just little things that are hidden up under in there, you know? And so I was just like, I repent and I release it. And I breathed it out. Like, Yahushua Mashiach, take this away from me and close the door on that. Thank you, you know? And then I had peace for a little bit. And then something else came up and I had to go through it again and go through it again. And then I found in my brain where it was. And then I was like, oh, this was from a birthday party when something happened. And I just was like, oh, I repent of that. And I forgive the person and I forgive myself. And Holy Father, please just take this away from me and close the door and just breathe it out. And I just kept feeling, you know, just... It's like bugs or something. It's not bugs, but I guess things that bug you, right? Things, little things that are hidden back in there that bug you while you're living your life are things that the enemy can use to just give you a hard time, right? So we need to get rid of those things and we need to close the door. So I'm going through this process, trying to sleep, mind you. I wasn't trying to do this. I wanted to sleep, but I had to go through this warfare. And what happened was, I got to a certain point where it started to be quiet, right? Like I thought, I was like, oh, I got everything. And then I saw light, not light, like enlightenment, like I saw the first time. It was just kind of like the northern lights, you know, like colored soft lights in darkness, right? My eyes are closed. I'm seeing like kind of northern lights like that. And I was like, oh, I think I broke through. I got rid of whatever that was, right? And then I heard Holy Yahushua's voice, and it was far. It was like if it was a radio, it was like, can you hear me? It wasn't interference, but it was far like that. And he was yelling and he was like, he said, I'm trying to tell you something. Do you understand? And I was like, I was in shock, right? Because I'm here sleeping and I hear Holy Yahushua yelling like he's far, trying to get through the interference. He was like, I'm trying to tell you something. Do you understand? And I was like, no, I don't understand. No, I don't understand, Holy Yahushua. Can you say that again, please? But that's when I understood that Holy Yahushua was trying to give me this very important message. And the enemy was distracting me. That's what they were trying to keep me from being able to hear. So that's why I had to go through all of this, go to the radio, right? This is your radio receiver. I had to clean out, you know, the bugs so that I could receive Holy Yahushua's message. So all of that, I'm saying that to help you to know the level of the work that has to be done you on yourself to be able to get through these levels, to be able to hear Holy Yahushua, to receive your name and yada, yada, etc. Okay, this is a hands-on, full-time job, introspective, quiet, and full of dedication. That's what you have to do. So I can't tell you what he said, but I received the message. So I'm going to show you the results of the message, okay? This is the result of the messages, okay? They're not in order. There's some that I received before and some, and the one that I just received that I just explained. I'm just going to show you the messages in total, okay? And go from there. So the message in total has to do mostly with priest Joshua Sampson that I introduced to you last week. And in this particular message I received July 21st at 4:49 a.m., it says that each group has to have protection. So, you know, we're in groups of five at the moment to sing his name. And that we have to read Psalms 55, Psalms 22, and Psalms 101, okay? That is specifically what I received, and Priest Joshua as well received the same confirmation. He also received that we're to read 55, 22, 101, and he also received 91, which we're already reading every day, Psalms 91. So Priest, these Psalms right here are what you need for your group protections, okay? And that's why every Friday, Priest Joshua Sampson will be doing the prayer protection for our prayer group before we start our service. This is important for you to be reading Psalms 55, 22, and 101 every week as much as you can, as much as you need. This is the message I got. And that Priest Joshua is to set that seal of fire protection over us. So we're in groups of five. He's going to be meeting with everyone and praying with us as a prayer warrior to set a seal of protection over each group. And that we will be beginning this week. So this is the dream I had about Priest Joshua Sampson, and I shared with you last week that he is to choose. Actually, what I received directly in the dream was specifically that he is to choose the next seven people for the menorah. Okay, that right here, that's what I was literally told in the dream after my interpretation was about leading the menorah. But here we know specifically he's to choose the seven. And the last message I received, I got at 1:44 a.m. So I took two screenshots. The first one I took to show the time, 1:46, because after I woke up at 1:44 to write it, but by the time I typed it out, it was 1:46, but I took the screenshot to prove the time. And then I corrected the screenshot. And so I corrected the message, which gave me a different time. So I had to take two screenshots. But the message was, Joshua is to stamp each group of five. There is an animal sign or another sign, the elements, he will identify them. Holy is Yahushua. Holy Yahushua was in this showing me. So in the dream, Holy Yahushua showed me Priest Joshua not only praying over the people, as we saw in the message before, but talking to each person and helping them understand what their element is. And what I understand now and what we've understood together is that your element is your power, like we learned from Priest Karma's daughter, I think it was a week or 2 weeks ago, she was talking about the different colors. And so, you know, a person who has the fire and a person who has the water and all of that, that is your weapon against the enemy. So he's going to help each person understand their powers. And I don't understand what it means about animals yet, but we know that the work that has to be done is tied with Priest Joshua Sampson. I can't tell you exactly what Holy Yahushua told me. He told me I had to keep it secret, but this is the point. The point is that our eighth person in our menorah is Priest Joshua Sampson. This week, Holy Yahushua has given me all of these dreams. Like, this is July 19th. This is July 14th, July 21. So within a week and a half, he's given me like four direct messages about Priest Joshua is responsible for choosing the next seven people, the next menorah. That is his job. And so he will be choosing whether or not Prince Abasi will be the olive tree for the second menorah. I don't know. But Father has specifically come and explain to me that our eighth person is Priest Joshua Sampson, and that is direct order directly from Holy Yahushua. And so that is
how it is. So we are complete. We have our eight people. And just like Holy Father uses people's names in the Bible, you know, when you look up people's names in the Bible, you can understand messages just from their names. He does that in real life. He did that with us. He used priest Uriel Thomas. His birth name is David. And Holy Father used David to give us messages about David, right? King David. If you remember, if you go back and the way we received the message about noon and all of that happened, that came through Uriel Thomas because his name is David. Do you remember that? Also, right now with priest Joshua Sampson, Holy Father is using him to show us where we are at this time. And at this time, it's when we as Yisrael are ready to go over the Jordan and go to the promised land. This is the interior process of that. This is the spiritual process of that. Before we have the actual physical manifestation of the Exodus, we have to go through this in the inside. And this is what we explained recently, the revelation from priest Ariel Carissa about the seven enemies of Israel actually being, in, when we're talking about inside of us, the seven deadly sins. So we've understood that him, priest Joshua Sampson, receiving the name Joshua is symbolic of the work that he's going to do with us in Wakefulness Theology to help us to get up these levels and to do the necessary so that we're cleaned and to help us fight against the seven enemies of Yisrael. This is what we're understanding. And we can clearly see the difference of work between a candlestick and an olive tree. It's very different work and it's very different anointings. And, you know, like we've said, it's possibly coming from the spirit. One is the spirit of Elijah. One is the spirit of Enoch. However you want to understand it, it's very different roles. And we can see that alive and in priest Joshua Sampson. So this is made very clear, and Holy Father has used his name to confirm to us where we are in this process. As well, he has done the same thing with priest Prince Abasi. Because his name is Prince, that's how Father showed me the configuration of the two olive trees and the two candlesticks. We've already talked about that, the six lambs and the ram. And the prince here, and confirmation about us singing on the new moons, which we received from Leland Jones. So that is a very important reason why Father brought him, so that I would understand this message here. And again, he used the name. We also had confirmation from priest Prince Abasi about there are people in our group who think they're priests and they are not. Now, this is a message we've already received. We already knew it, but now it's confirmed. And at this point, Father is going to start to divide out those who actually are and those who are not, because you cannot, as I explained at the beginning of this video, you cannot go up those levels if you are not about that life 100%, and the separation is about to come now. So that was another message we received from Prince Abasi. And the third was a confirmation about what I'm telling you right now about what is necessary in order to get up these levels, which is complete surrender. Complete surrender, complete surrender to the Most High, His will. Okay, so now everyone is updated, and we will keep you updated as the second menorah forms, and we'll let you know how that goes. We're coming to the end of this video right here. This is what we're going to talk about next week. We need to start dealing with these seven enemies of Yisrael. They are pride, greed, wrath, envy, lust, gluttony, and sloth. And We did a whole study on Shazam, and now we understand how real and how true that movie really is. You know, we might need to watch it again. And in the movie, it was about the seven deadly sins. This, and here, this is a screenshot from the movie right here. It's not from the movie, but the comic book Shazam. And you can see that they say right here, the seven deadly enemies of man. So again, confirmation that the enemies of Israel are actually the seven deadly sins here. So again, it's only you that's going to keep you from going up those levels. If you are able to get rid of these things inside of yourself, then you will be able to finally bond and assemble with your brethren. Then you're going to receive your powers, and then we're going to be ready to kick butt when we sing 8 times and we are cleaned. And then the enemy cannot do anything, and he's running scared. So there you go, priest. But I think you understand the work that has to be done on this first level to even start. This is the work you have to do. So if you're not ready yet, if you haven't made it to this place yet, if you are still alone and you don't have anybody else with you, then this is the work you have to do. If you need help, I pray that you reach out and we'll do what we can. Love you so very much in Christ. Have a blessed, beautiful Sabbath, and talk to you next week. All glory and honor to the Most High Father. Thank you, Holy Father, for all your blessings. Thank you for guiding us and talking to us and teaching us and just making sure that we do not go astray, and keeping us in your wings and your loving arms of protection. In Yahushua HaMashiach's holy name we pray. Amen. Shalom, priest. Shalom.